positive psychology is essentially the study of what makes life good, what contributes to us being happy, what contributes to meaning in life, and so forth. And he, in some respects, this wasn't new, because psychology back in the early part of the 1900s was very interested in creativity and some of the more positive aspects of being human. And then the World Wars came, and particularly after World War II, with readjustment issues for veterans, actually there was a lot of need for psychologists to pay attention to helping veterans readjust after the war. And in fact, the VA became the leading employer of psychologists. So psychology at that point kind of moved toward how do we help people solve problems in their life, their lives, basically. And so positive psychology kind of got lost. And even though there was some research over the years being done, nothing like what happened after the year that Seligman was APA president. So a lot of what I'm going to be talking about tonight is from research that's been done since the late 1900s, although you'll see some of the research was done earlier. But it's still a big area, and I expect it will continue to grow, because think about our Constitution, or I guess it was the Declaration of Independence, I should say. Basic rights considered life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. That seems to be something that we want in our lives. You know, and if you ask people, you know, just kind of in a general way, what do you want in your life? One of the things people often will say is, I want to be happy. So let's talk tonight about what we know about what goes into being happy. So we're going to start with these questions. And what I'm going to do is, it's kind of a complex multiple choice question, because to answer it, you've got to determine, of the four options, which option has three true statements. So I guess there are really 12 statements there. So we're going to go through those. So the first question is, or the statement is, what I expect to happen tomorrow is more important for today's well-being than how today compares to yesterday. And actually, that's false. How today compares to yesterday really seems to affect how we feel today more than what we expect tomorrow. Now, that's not to say that you know, being hopeful or looking forward to what tomorrow holds is, I'm not suggesting that's not important. But in terms of how we evaluate today and how that affects our mood, we tend to compare it to yesterday. And we'll come back to that in a little while, but suppose yesterday it had been incredibly hot here and the heat index was 120 degrees. What would we be saying about today's weather? It's cooler. Okay. When, you know, we were talking earlier about how hot it is out, because this is considered hotter than many summer days, right? So we often do compare how things are today to what we just experienced. And one of the reasons for this is tomorrow is still unknown. We might have something that we're looking forward to, which again, hope is a big part of our happiness and well-being. But in terms of how I feel today, yesterday seems more important. You also can think about this with regard to health. If you had been ill yesterday and you're feeling better today, then typically you notice health more today than you would have otherwise. I mean, we often, if we're feeling good, we take health for granted. By the way, if there's any questions about this, get my attention. So that statement's actually more false than true. Meaningful work is more important to well-being than is having good relationships. I see some heads shaking no. That is false. some of those, in fact, one of the scholars, psychologists, did a whole lot of work in positive psychology, unfortunately died suddenly several years ago, Chris Peterson. But he would say, if you could sum up positive psychology in one brief statement, it would be that good relationships matter. So if you could only pick one thing as an ingredient for happiness, it would be having good relationships in your life. So again, this isn't to suggest that meaningful work isn't important, but it's not as important to people's well-being as having good relationships. And I should mention here that the kinds of things I'm talking about today would be on average. So if we look at a particular individual, we might find some exceptions to some of these basic findings. So we're talking about on average. So the next statement, most things aren't as bad as expected, nor as good as expected. I see some heads shaking, yes. That is true. So depending whether somebody expects something to be bad or whether they expect it to be good, I guess is whether or not this is good news, right? And the reason for this is that we are remarkably adaptable as human beings. I have to say, in my years as a psychologist, I'm amazed often at what people are able to cope with in their lives. And so, bad events indeed can bring us down emotionally. But remarkably, people tend to find a way to adapt and sort of return to baseline. Not always, but in many cases. For example, grieving. You know, grieving can take a long time depending upon what the loss was. But when you think about it, most people are able to get through a grieving process successfully, if you will. Now, the other part of this, good things we adapt to as well. So think about when you wanted to get something new. You're looking forward to it and you think, gosh, when I have this, I'm going to be happier. Let's say it's a new car, and you get it, and you're happy with your new car, and you look forward to opportunities to drive it. And if it's truly a new car, you know, you experience the new car smell each time you get in it. And you might tell people about your new car, but for how long? At some point, you stop referring to it as your new car, and it's just your car. And that's long before there's anything wrong with it, unless it was a lemon. So my point is, something new, some change, be it good or bad, tends to affect our well-being for a period of time, but then it becomes the usual. I can remember my oldest son has an intellectual disability, and when we were just kind of discovering this and sort of thinking about what's this mean for his future and so forth, I can remember at the time I worked in the VA system here in town, I can remember specifically walking across the VA campus thinking, life is good if only Max didn't have this disability. But that didn't really last very long. Now, it's not that I don't know he has an intellectual disability, but that's Max, that's my son. So I was aware of it more when it was new, when it was different, but now that's usual. Okay. So I can't say Max's disability detracts from my happiness or well-being, although it did initially. Does that make sense? And then the same with good things, you know. You know, we talk about the grass looks greener, and when we cross the fence, it may well be greener, but then we adapt to it. Questions about this?
Does that mean we automatically gravitate to mediocrity and everything?
Does that mean we gravitate toward mediocrity? I guess in the context of positive psychology, I prefer to think about that a little bit differently. Then it's not necessarily mediocrity, but it will talk a little bit later on about how we do all seem to have sort of a baseline level of happiness to which we do tend to return. Now, having said that, we can affect it, but nonetheless, many things in our lives don't result in an enduring change in our level of happiness, although some things can. But one of the things that doesn't tends to be things. And most people don't find that too surprising. And in a little while, we'll talk about money and where that fits into this equation.
Well, I was going to say, so we need a lot of new things.
Mm-hmm. You know, and
we need to be spoiled. Just stay away from the mediocrity.
Actually, the fact that we think something new is going to make me happier is great for our economy.
Bad for our wallet.
Bad for our wallets, good for our economy. So, you know, and one of the ways that persons who are selling products get us to buy things is changing them. Okay, so clothing styles change. If clothing styles didn't change so much, I wouldn't need something new as much as I do if styles change, right? Or back to new cars, you know? It's got new features now, new design, new bells and whistles. So actually, even though sometimes the pursuit of things that will make us happier is called the hedonic treadmill, that we kind of keep chasing after, oh, this is going to make me happier. And it does for a while, so it kind of reinforces that belief. But then I'm kind of back to baseline, so I need the next new thing.
That's what I mean. We need a lot.
That's right. But if I don't bring this up again, we'll come back to that when we talk about where we do have some more control over enduring happiness. And one of the things is, again, good relationships. And that doesn't mean you always going out and finding a new relationship, because that obviously has its own set of problems. But finding meaning and purpose in the relationships that one already has. We'll go there and then we'll come here.
Okay, thanks. Could you give us the evidence about the second part of the statement? I mean, the second one, meaningful work is more important to all these. I mean, I have some doubts about that. Could you give us an evidence or something?
I've got another. There's another statement later that we'll come back to. And again, in terms of job satisfaction, there's evidence that your job being meaningful is more important to your to liking your job than is how much you get paid, which sometimes employers don't realize. They think, okay, my employee will like his or her job more if I pay them more. But actually, work being meaningful would be a more important ingredient there. But in terms of the research that suggests, in terms of, let's say, life satisfaction is a pie. How big of a piece is meaningful work, and how big of a piece would be good relationships? The research would suggest that good relationships constitute a bigger piece of the pie than meaningful work.
So, for example, if I would like to help some people, and they might not—they might think that it's not good to them, but it's actually the good thing I'm doing for them. So if they think that it's not good for them, and by the way, causes a bad relationship among us, so which one is most important for me to do? Doing the good thing to them, or maintaining the good relationship?
Well, I think that either or makes it tricky. If we took this together, having good relationships in the workplace would be the ideal. Having a meaningful job and good relationships in the workplace would be kind of the ideal. And we'll come back to work in just a moment as well.
So would you say it's relative to the individual? So for example, someone wants to run a marathon and finishes and they're ecstatic and they're very happy, and someone who has a physical disability wants to walk to the corner and that makes them very happy. So it's relative to the
individual. I would say that's relative to the individual, yeah, absolutely. I mentioned my son earlier, and you mentioned marathon. Interestingly, in February, he ran the Los Angeles Marathon. So, and I, hands down, distance running has been probably the best thing in his life in terms of activities and so forth. So, back on work, characteristics of a job are important contributors to how happy a person is in the job. That is true, but look at this. Not as important how happy the person tends to be overall. Happy people tend to like their jobs, and unhappy people tend to dislike their jobs. So if you're an employer, and it's important to you that you have happy employees, hire happy people.
Is there a happy scale?
It's a test.
Is there a happy test?
It's a test.
And you mentioned meaningful work and good paying work. Garbage collectors. It's a very important job. We've got to have them. It pays really well. I don't think any of them are happy.
I would beg to differ. There are folks in those kind of jobs that are happy. And back to your question about meaningful work. One occupational groups that's been studied would be hospital housekeepers. Okay? Most people would say, you know, in terms of the totem pole, that's lower level. And often the work they're doing is not pleasant work. Okay. What they found was that how these folks thought about their work had a huge impact on how happy they were with their jobs. So those who saw their role as an important part of the healthcare team, which it is, I mean, that's just not, you know, who wants to go to the hospital into a room that's not been cleaned? So their role is vitally important, and those who saw it as such were much happier people than those who saw their work as, well, you know, kind of all I am is a hospital housekeeper. So in fact, one of the things that certainly could have an enduring impact on one's happiness is finding different ways to think about circumstances in one's life. So framing a job in a more positive light.
Not to interrupt or anything, but just kind of to go on to that same point is, as an employer, you should also help encourage your employees to see their job as a different light. For example, I think I've read somewhere where housekeepers in a hotel were just completely dissatisfied in their job, but they were like, you know, they're not happy, they're not, you know, getting out to reach their goals, if it's a weight loss or things like that. But the, you know, managers of them mentioned, like, look at how much work you're doing, you know, how much calories you're burning, look
physical
at how many miles, and then all of a sudden they love their jobs because look at what they're accomplishing. You know, they're not just cleaning a bedroom, you know, or a room, they're walking 6-7 miles a day. And so I love this part of it because it's not just the hiring happy people, it's helping train your employees to, this is your impact in the business, and here's what all you're accomplishing, and here's the bigger picture.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I would agree. I think the employer can have certainly have some impact on it.
Is there a happy scale?
Is there a happy scale?
Or is that something we're getting?
No, I'm trying to think. There's a website, authentichappiness.org, I think will get you there, that Martin Seligman, who I mentioned earlier, has put together. There's a bunch of scales. For example, later we'll talk about positive and negative emotion. For example, there's a scale there, how much positive emotion, how much negative emotion. There's a satisfaction with life scale, which is a very brief scale. So there are various scales. I'm not sure there's actually one happiness scale per se, but there's a lot of scales out there. Aha, here's another tricky one, huh? Having children contributes to relationship satisfaction for a couple. That's false. If you're to draw a graph of satisfaction of couples, and again, this is satisfaction with the relationship. What you tend to see is something like this. And these are the child rearing years. Now, I'm not here to say that children aren't meaningful or contribute to our life satisfaction. And sometimes it's hard to distinguish what do we mean by happiness, what do we mean by meaningfulness, what do we mean by satisfaction. And I would probably argue that meaningfulness and satisfaction is probably where children come in a little more than happiness per se, at least during these years when there's a lot of stress associated with raising children. I also think that one of the reasons we find this is a mistake couples often make, I consider this a mistake, is putting the children at the center of their lives rather than their relationship. And that's not to say I'm suggesting we ignore our children or in any sort of way, but that the most important relationship in the family is the relationship among the parents. Not a problem. And that being a good relationship is one of the best things we can do for our kids. So I think some of that probably is the couple not attending to their relationship as much as is really necessary when they're raising kids. Yes, sir?
I also want to point out on that marital satisfaction that after the children leave home, the marital satisfaction actually increases above what it was at marriage, at the honeymoon, which I always point out as being important for people to stay in marital relationships. Sometimes it's difficult. Because if you weather the stress of the childbearing years, in the long term, you'll actually be more satisfied. But a lot of people get divorced in those hard years, mm-hmm. remarry, and then go through the entire cycle again.
Excellent point. And this is on a later slide, but one of the myths about aging is that as people get older, they get less happy. Actually, the evidence is to the contrary, that on average, as people get older, they're happier. And so that could be a contributing factor there as well. We talked about all that. So one's choice and point of comparison for one's circumstances affects life satisfaction. That's true. Most things that we evaluate in some way, we're evaluating with respect to something else. We're doing some comparison. And in some cases, we can't change our circumstances, but we can control what it is we choose to compare our circumstances to. Now, my office is in West Dayton, near Good Sam Hospital, and a number of the neighborhoods right around Good Sam have over the years become more run down. Don't have to go very far to find some boarded up houses. Okay. So if I think about comparing my house to those, I feel very fortunate. Now, I don't know if anybody here is involved with Homerama, and I'm not anti-Homerama, but if I go to Homerama, and then I drive home to my house, how satisfied am I with my house?
I think that's everybody, though.
Well, and where it's everybody is that's how we compare things. So I like to say to people, if you're unhappy with your house, go to Homerama. I mean, I'm sorry. If you want to be unhappy with your house, go to Homerama. That's right. So, you know, we talk about keeping up with the Joneses, that phrase. Again, we choose if we want to compare our circumstances to the Joneses, or if we want to compare our circumstances to somebody else. So I would suggest that one of the ways we can have some enduring bump in our happiness level is this whole point here. What are we comparing our circumstances to? And I'll use an example when I worked at the VA. I would have people who came to my office who had perhaps severe mental health issues or severe physical health problems. And it was interesting. By the time they got to my office, some would sometimes come in and say, you know, just walking through the lobby down there and seeing some of the things some of the other patients are dealing with, I feel better about my circumstances already. And again, so what's happening there? It's the point of comparison.
Comment about that. Felt like with the houses, if you want to feel bad about your house, go look at Homerama. One of the points of Homerama is to dream. And years ago, obviously, there was a television show called Lifestyles of the Rich and Famous, Champagne Wishes and Caviar Dreams. And people watch that. Most people are never going to have that. Are we going to have a house like Madonna? Probably not. But people were entertained by that, and they felt it was fun. I mean, it was fun to dream and say, well, okay, now the half hour's over. But people watch that show week after week, year after year, because it made them feel good.
Yeah.
That's a little against this psychology note at the moment.
Perhaps. I think some of it is whether or not one is able to kind of keep it in the realm of dream or truly use that as a point of comparison. You know, so if I'm, you know, and sometimes if we compare ourselves to something so much better that we can't even imagine ever being there, it's probably going to affect us less than the whole comparing ourselves to the Joneses, where it might be kind of more attainable, but we still can't quite get it. And again, one of the challenging things in the behavioral sciences is, yes, we can find these trends, but in most cases, 100% of the research doesn't fall in that one area. So there are some things that seem to have truth on both sides. You've heard the phrase, two heads are better than one, which suggests that we ought to have more people involved in the decision, let's say. But then you also, too many cooks spoil the broth. And probably in certain circumstances, both are true.
Camel is a horse designed by committee.
There you go.
There you go. Camel is a horse designed by committee. Mental wellness and mental illness are on the same continuum. That's false. There's certainly some overlap, not as much as most people think. I said here, it's not like a teeter-totter. So it's not like if somebody's got a mental illness that happiness automatically goes down, or vice versa. The correlation in one good study was -0.53. And again, if you translate that into how big of a piece of the pie is the overlap, it's only a little over a quarter of the pie. Now, I've got some more about this. And we're going to talk about this term flourishing for just a moment. Most people without a mental illness aren't flourishing, which means they don't have as good of mental health as they possibly could, which is one of the reasons why I think positive psychology is so important. First of all, mental health is more than the absence of mental illness. And I think terminology here is not the best, because when we often think about mental health, we're thinking about mental disorders or mental health problems rather than flourishing or mental wellness. So we'll talk about languishing and flourishing here for a moment. So if we look at the presence of a mental illness or not, and then we look at where people are in the continuum of flourishing, high-level mental wellness, moderately mentally healthy, or languishing, which would be a low level of mental wellness. Those who have a mental illness and are languishing is about 7% of the population. 14.5% of the population were found to have a mental illness but be moderately mentally healthy. And a very small percentage have a mental illness and are flourishing. And in a moment, we'll define flourishing a little bit more. But this bottom section, I think, is what's really important. About 10% of the population have no mental illness but are languishing. That is, have a pretty low level of mental wellness. Or you could say are pretty unhappy. About half the population has no mental illness and are moderately mentally healthy. That's not all bad, but that suggests that there's only something over 15% of the population have the kind of mental wellness they really could have, that they're flourishing. So if you just take people who have no mental illness, that's almost 60% of the population whose mental health, mental wellness, could actually be better.
I guess I'm going back to the scale thing. So what is your measuring stick for languishing, flourishing, and moderately?
So these would be the kind of things that go into what we consider flourishing. Okay, experiencing a lot of positive emotion. That the person's emotional state, on average, is pretty positive. That they would say the quality of my life is good. They're accepting of themselves with strengths and limitations. They kind of live life in a sense that they still want to grow, want relationships to grow, maybe want their knowledge to grow, want to have good experiences, new experiences, feel that life's purposeful, that they've got some control over the circumstances around them or can have some influence on it. And that they have feel a sense of autonomy. That in one of the earlier sessions we talked about your emotional car being in the driver's seat. That yes, I'm an autonomous person in that respect. And then notice a lot of this is in the relationship realm. Having good relationships with other people, feeling accepted by others, social actualization. I think that's a term that's somewhat hard to define, but pursuing what you're capable of in terms of relationships with other people, investing in relationships being good, trying to contribute in a manner to relationships that they grow, contributing to society, feeling like social circles are meaningful, that you fit in a meaningful way, and then actually being integrated into society. So, I mean, that talks about a lot, but if we look at this, a lot of it's about relationships, and then certainly there's a lot of intrapersonal kinds of things here as well. One criticism I would have of the United States and our culture is that I think we're individualized to our own detriment, so that we focus too much on that side of the equation and not enough on the we. We're too much about the I. And I think as a society, we potentially could be happier if we were more about community. Now, having said that, that's a very broad statement. But even you know, our the way neighborhoods are being built now has changed somewhat. But if we go back a few decades to the way suburbs were created, they tended to not be about, you know, knowing your neighbors. It was more about, you know, one of the things was no sidewalks. And it's there's evidence that when there are sidewalks, people are more likely to know their neighbors. And so interestingly now, there's a trend toward building community, or places like the Green, where you have business residents together rather than it being all separate. So I think there's some trends that, in a sense, are pushing community.
There's no porches anymore.
Porches, good point. I also think I think as part of the behavioral sciences, one of the things we've not done in terms of our contribution to society is the kind of thing we're talking about tonight. That we've focused more on what can we do to prevent mental health problems or how can we treat mental illness, but a whole lot less on what are the ingredients for happiness. There was an article in the paper within the past week or 10 days, the Daily News, about how employers are clamoring to have employees who have soft skills, relationship skills. Now, I'm not anti-STEM, and when I mean STEM, science, technology, engineering, mathematics, by any means. I consider psychology a science, and I value science a great deal. However, I think perhaps we've swung the pendulum too much so that my wife, who's a longtime elementary school teacher, over the years saw art taken away from her students, phys ed time reduced, music reduced, that kind of thing. There were some school districts in the United States that actually would have curricula in what's called social and emotional learning. Some of that is relationship skills. How do you deal with conflict? Interestingly, that kind of education has been shown to reduce vulnerability to drug and alcohol abuse. But when we have tight budgets, those are often the soft skill kinds of things are the ones that get abandoned. So I think there are a number of things we probably haven't done well in terms of what would contribute to a higher level of happiness as a country. All right, let me move on. I don't want to run out of time. So when we are find these people who are flourishing, yes, they have better mental health. They also have better physical health, and they also tend to be more productive and more satisfied in the workplace. So if there's any point to take away from this last, the whole issue about mental health and mental illness is that I think there's a, for most people who have no mental illness, there's still a lot of growth that they potentially can have in terms of the well-being in life. More money means more happiness. I see a head nod. And initially, the literature probably would have been saying no, but this is true to an extent. And where it's true, mostly, is if you take somebody from poverty to what would be considered a more basic standard of living. That's one place where, indeed, you find a bump in happiness that's sustained. After that, so sort of like right there from poverty to, and how do you define a basic standard of living? Well, we could argue about that for a long time, right? But whatever that would be a bump in happiness. After that, increases in wealth tend to be associated with just a slight, one of the things they struggle with is you know, people sort of come out of the woodwork to be their friends, and, you know, do they really want to be my friend, or are they interested in me because of my money or my stature or whatever? So. This is probably a little hard to see, but and this is the data are from the early 2000s. But what they did was look at the gross domestic product, one indicator of a country's economy. And so increasing wealth for countries is coming this way on the graph, the horizontal dimension. And then life satisfaction is on the vertical dimension. Okay. So, you know, if you were to do some analysis of this, you would indeed find a line indicating more wealth on average, more life satisfaction. But you can also see some exceptions here. You see where the United States is. And by the way, the bigger the circle, the larger the country in terms of population. So the U.S., China over here, India, large circles.
But what's interesting is, so how does Venezuela get so happy on so little? You know, that's what I would want to find out.
Mm-hmm. Yep, certainly. Now, what, Saudi Arabia is known as a wealthy country, but then there are some others in there that aren't so wealthy.
They're not as happy as Venezuela.
Yeah.
Do you have any answer to that? Good weather?
No winter?
Venezuela has, I actually have a friend who played the Dayton Dragons, and he, it's very corrupt. I mean, it's not safe. Like, he doesn't bring his family back there. So I'm just curious.
Yeah. I don't have an answer specifically for Venezuela. There are, let's say, some of the places, and I don't know enough about their culture specifically, but typically in cultures that are happier, you do tend to find more of a sense of community, more of this sense of we. There are probably some exceptions to that. They've found some correlation between how well countries do economically and happiness or well-being, and some would argue we should be paying more attention to happiness in countries and looking at their how successful or well-off they are. Interestingly, and this has been fairly consistent, the Scandinavian countries typically rank fairly high in happiness. And so immediately, if you think about weather, you know, these are countries that have long, dark winters, right? Yes?
It's also been found that in countries where there's a wide range of income and wealth, there's usually less happiness than in countries where there's more uniform distribution of wealth. And so you have a poor country, but everybody's poor. So they're happy.
Yeah.
And other countries where there's some extremely rich and some extremely poor, those people are less happy.
Yeah. I guess what income inequity is, I think that's right. The term that we often hear. Interestingly, that's also been looked at in the United States. And you do find that states with more income inequity tend to have more social problems, less happiness and so forth. States where there's less income inequity. So that's been found internationally as well as here in the United States. So you're right, and some would point to that in the Scandinavian countries. There, you know, you can find folks who are more well-to-do or well-off than others, but the gap isn't nearly as wide as it is here in the United States.
Denmark is very, aren't they the country that has, it's almost socialist, I mean, because everything is free. I mean, healthcare is free? Is that, am I thinking the right
The Scandinavian
country?
Countries as a group tend to be more socialist. And so a lot of times people say, you know, you don't want to live there because you have to pay so much of your income in taxes. Well, when you look at this, you know, maybe at least the way they're doing it, it seems like people are relatively happy. One of the things, too, is that because of that, I think many people who might be more vulnerable in those societies are more confident in the safety net, if you will. We talked about this 2 months ago, I think, when we went in the Brain Matters. In a relationship, how one responds when the other shares good news is more important for the relationship than how the couple manages conflict. And that appears to have some truth. And we talked about this a little bit, but I know from month to month, not always do we have the same people here, so I'm going to review that briefly again. The whole idea is kind of capitalizing on good experiences, both sharing the good experience and then how I respond when somebody in my family, my significant other, or whatever, shares good news with me. And so that's referred to as capitalization. So the sharing of good news can be good for both. This is about how to respond to the sharing of good news. We look at it on two dimensions, a passive response or an active response, and then a constructive response or a destructive response. So a passive destructive response would be, not that she was searching for, but let's assume my wife came home and said, I got the job as principal, which is something she wanted. And I say, well, congratulations, but now you're probably going to have to work longer hours and you're going to have a lot more problems to deal with. So, active destructive would be taking the air out of the person's balloon.
Negative answer.
Yeah, exactly. Let me point out all the downsides. That would be active destructive. Passive destructive would be, oh, that's nice. And did you like today's weather? So virtually no response would be passive destructive. Passive constructive would be a little bit more. Oh, that's nice. I know that was something you were looking forward to. An active constructive response would be, that's great. Tell me more about it. So I want to, you know, I'm going to give her an opportunity to relish in it. Now, if I do that, what happens for her? Yeah, she gets more excited. She gets to re-experience it. And what happens for me? I get to feel good. I get to share in some of that, right? And as we talked about before, each time she shares the good news, that's further embedding it in her memory so that her memory library kind of has a bigger section of that. So she's kind of building her good memory library, if you will.
You add to her.
I'm sorry?
You add to her.
Absolutely. It's sort of a synergistic effect. In terms
I'm
of
happy energy. We're all happy.
There you go. So in relationships, in terms of building relationships, this is something I think we can specifically look at. When a family member has some good news to share, look at it as an opportunity to do this active constructive responding. It's actually fairly simple. Be enthusiastic and ask them to tell you more. In Shelley Gable's study, what she found was that active and constructive responding was a better predictor of relationships continuing than was how these couples were handling conflict. So that's what got this research on the map, because one of the things we often focus on in relationships is conflict management. We talked about this earlier. Happy people like their jobs. And some of this also is adaptation. That that if indeed we adapt to circumstances, what our baseline is, then is going to probably have some effect on how we report, how we like our jobs. We perhaps could have talked about this a little more earlier, but one of the things that typically brings pleasure to us is new, if the new is desirable. Okay, if it's an undesirable, obviously it's going to bring us down. But newness itself seems to have a big impact on us. And I think that's one of the reasons also in relationships why sometimes we get the downward. It's not just children, that it doesn't become, it's not new any longer. So you've heard of the 7-year itch in a marriage.
It's also true that same relationship existed in childless couples. After a period of the marriage, when the satisfaction goes down, the time comes back
up. And it comes back up. So,
it's related to, I think, the longer you're in a relationship, the more you know about the other person, the more familiar you are with that other person, and you're sharing your interests, the more similar, literally, you become.
Sure.
And, it's a couple that no longer have to speak because they know what each other's thinking. It's a very comforting, satisfying relationship. Change would be upsetting the apple cart.
I'm not an artist, so you have to bear with me. The solid line would be passionate love, which is largely about newness.
Short-term.
Yeah, it's relatively short-term. Or if you will, the honeymoon in a new job. And a lot of that has to do with newness. And then, that doesn't mean you can't still have, some thrill, if you will, but it never can be new again. This line is the better predictor of longevity in relationships, often referred to as companionate love, which is, appreciation of each other, discovering shared interests, where you have differences, adapting to them, and so forth. So this is certainly a danger point in relationships. And hopefully, just kind of knowing that helps us adapt. So the new job that you wanted, that was great, you're not always going to have the same thrill with it because it's no longer new. Because some of the thrill is the newness. Next time we'll talk a little more about health behaviors, but if let's say you like hot fudge sundaes, there's probably nobody in here that does. And let's say you haven't had one in a while, and you're going to have one tonight. Which bite of that hot fudge sundae is probably going to taste the best? First bite. It's going to taste a whole lot better than the last. Some of it is this, that even with eating that, we begin to adapt. Now, so for somebody trying to manage weight, if you're going to have some high-calorie snack treat that you really like, kind of keep that in mind, that the best bites are going to be those first few bites. So maybe those are the only bites I need. Now, if that's the case, then I really should savor those bites. So that first bite, I should keep in my mouth as long as I possibly can and truly savor it. But what do we typically do when we get something that we really like? We gobble it down and then it's gone. We talked about this earlier, how one feels today depends on how today compares to yesterday. Weather's a good example. People tend to be inaccurate at predicting what will make them happy, true or false. It is true. People People are really good about saying how they feel right now. We're not so good about saying how we felt when, because our memories of how we felt tend to change over time. And it turns out we're really not very good at all about predicting what will make us happy. And there are reasons for that. So, let me give you an example. If somebody would ask me, if you could live anywhere in the United States, where would you go? One of the first places that comes to my mind is San Diego. Now, what's behind that? I've been to San Diego twice in my life. One time it was, I had a friend there, and one of my lingering memories is walking on the beach. So I associate San Diego with walking on the beach. I was also there for a meeting once, and my meeting didn't start till afternoon Pacific time. So since I was on Eastern time, I was awake early. I went out that morning for a run. And during the run, it got cloudy, it got a little windy, and it rained. And it was I probably didn't run, maybe, I don't know, maybe 40 minutes, 45 minutes. So that all happened in my 45-minute run. By the time I was back to the hotel, it had stopped raining. So I think my meeting started at 1. I turned on the noon news. And on the weather man there said, well, this morning we had the worst winter storm of the season. So that's my image of San Diego. Okay. So I think, oh, what a great place to live. All right, what am I leaving out?
Cost of living.
Cost of living? What else?
Pollution.
Traffic, which I understand is pretty bad.
Earthquakes, fire.
Okay, potentially earthquakes, fire, gets dry. How long my commute's likely to be? How often will I really go to the beach? So this example would be, what I'm doing is imagining something that would make me happy, but based on limited data, and then I'm filling in the gaps. So San Diego would be a great place to live, and I'm basing that on walking on the beach and the worst winter storm of the season. I had a friend who grew up in Ohio who lived in San Diego for a while, and I said, so how do you like the weather here? And he said, what weather? And it was interesting, I never thought about this. He said, I find it hard to remember when in the course of the year certain events have happened. He said, because growing up in Ohio, I associate events with weather. And in San Diego, you can't do that. Because most of the time, it's blue skies, right? After the fog's off.
But you adapt?
You adapt to that, absolutely. So I'm not poo-pooing San Diego, but what I'm saying is, if I truly want to live in San Diego, here's the person I need to be talking to. Somebody who's lived there. The person who's done a lot of this research is Daniel Gilbert. I forget what insurance company he's now doing some commercials for, but it's... he's got charts on the walls, and so Daniel Gilbert is his name. I don't remember what company it is, but the color scheme is more sort of white, yellow, and blue, I know.
Yeah.
Anyway, so I think it's the next slide. His argument is that if we think something will make us happy before we invest in it or make that decision to pursue it, find a surrogate. Find somebody who's actually lived it. Medical students, one of the big decisions in their lives is picking a residency. And so when we talk about some of the potential cognitive biases we have, a problem I'll give them is you've narrowed your top choice for residency down to two. They're in the same city. And you've got friends at both residency programs that are like you. You seem to have similar interests and so forth. At residency program A, your friends are really happy. A residency program B, they're not so happy. You decide to interview at both programs. You really don't have a very good interview day at residency A. You have a great interview day at residency B. So notice, your friends are happy at residency A, but you don't have a good interview day. Your friends aren't happy at residency B, you do have a good interview day. So the question then is, which residency should you rank first? Think about that in the context of what we're talking about here. We also tend to project the present into the future. You know, if I say to you something like, think about the car you'll be driving in 20 years. It's hard to imagine something different than the car you're driving now. So, because we can't fully appreciate what it will be, we take what we know and project it. And I'm not saying that's just because we don't have something else to do, that's just what we naturally do. My point is, it behooves us to be aware of how fallible that can be. That before I pick up and move to San Diego, I need to talk to somebody who's lived there. We also tend to underappreciate how different things will look when we actually experience something. And again, what we are failing to appreciate is our projection is probably based on a lot of shaky information, or at least limited information.
Don't you think we overblow? You know, like we went through it, and we didn't think it was that big a deal, but then years later we talk about how great it was.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, that's...
Yeah, you know, people talk about the 50s.
Yeah.
Okay, now how many of you would sign up for a much smaller house, one-car garage, and you only needed one-car garage because no matter how big your family was, if you had a car, it was one car.
No satellite TV.
Exactly. If you had a television, you might have had one and maybe up to three channels. And if you wanted to change the channel, you had to get up out of your seat and go all the way over across the room. Well, that wasn't that big of a room because your house was smaller. That's exactly. So, but my point is, we kind of romanticize the 50s. Now, there are lots of things that were good about the 50s, and part of it probably was people were comparing the 50s to what things were like during World War II. So, in comparison, they were great. And I'm not economically and lots of other ways they were good, but people think, oh, if we can only go back to how things were. Yeah. There are lots of reasons why many people would not choose to go back to the way things were when they really look at it.
Yeah. I mean, it just seems like everybody says the good old days. I mean, the good old days, really? Were they that good?
and some of that reflects our tendency over time. Remember I said that on average, and we're not talking about a steep curve, but on average, as people get older, they are happier. Some of that is how memories evolve and change over time. And if there's a tendency, typically it's for memories to be a little more positive. Now, our family vacations, I've got two boys, they're now in their 20s, but we had family vacations. And if I'm real specific about what I can remember some significant conflict. But on overall, when I think about family vacations, I think about them positively. And that's good for me and good for my health, my mental health. There is that tendency over time. And I think that's at work kind of among us, thinking about the good old days.
Confabulate.
And we tend, and it's good for us to remember the good times in the past more than the bad.
Also, when we're younger, we tend to equally remember bad and good experiences. But as you get older, you tend to predominantly remember the good times rather than the bad times, which biases our memory.
Yeah, and so that bias is good for us.
Yeah, that's very good.
Now, with this whole surrogate business, people would say, I can't find anybody just like me to tell me what it's like to live in San Diego or what it's like to work for this other company. I'm my own unique person. Hate to break this, but people are actually a lot more alike on many dimensions than they are different. And one of the things too, and I'd love to talk about this with our residents, because it's sometimes fun to trick them when they think they know a lot. On most dimensions, men and women are more alike than they are different. Flies in the face of men are from Mars and women are from Venus. Mm-hmm. But there are some areas where there are substantial differences, but in most areas, including most relationship kind of factors, we're more alike than we are different.
It's becoming more equal, isn't it? When did John Gray write that book? It's been like 20 years, I know. So don't you think?
And who would have bought his book, Men and Women Are Alike? Well, and we do tend to pay attention to differences. You know, if I go home tonight and my wife says, what were the individual people in your audience like? I'm going to try to highlight differences. I'm not going to go home and say, well, they were all the same.
I think you should say, they were all great.
I'll say that it was the best audience I've ever had.
And she said, tell me more.
She'll say, tell me more.
Or let me maybe a better illustration. Let's say we have a new employee, and I say we've got a new faculty member. She says, "What's that person like?" My tendency is going to be to talk about things and how that person might be different. It's sort of the way we characterize people. It can lead to a lot of problems, but I think we're sort of wired to pick out differences. On average, this is a hard number to get, but on average it's thought that personality is approximately 40% genetically driven. The rest is learned and molded. So it's thought that we all sort of have, I don't like the term set point. I would prefer to think in terms of a set range. You can probably think about people you know who just naturally seem to be pretty happy and up, and other people who seem to be a little more melancholic. So that's probably that 50% of the pie. What people are often really surprised about is that circumstances, and what I mean by circumstances are socioeconomics, where you live, who you live with, what your job is. Most people think, how can that only be 10%? Well, the reason is it's, again, adaptation. That those circumstances tend to be enduring, at least for significant periods of time in our lives, and so we adapt to them. Now, having said that, a change in circumstances for an individual is going to change things for at least a period of time. Now, the good news here, I would say, is 40% is where our control is. And that would be things like, while my job would be circumstances, how I choose to think about my job, what I find meaningful about my job, that would fall more into this other 40%. That's more intentional on my part. Or the circumstances might be, I have a wife. The intentional activity would be what I do and choose to do to invest in nurturing that marriage versus taking it for granted. What do I do with my free time? What do I do that I find relaxing? So these are the things that would fall into the 40%. Another example would be what I choose to compare my circumstances to. And when I say set range, what we do with this other 40% is where they can be movement. Now, somebody who's genetically maybe a little more, tends to be a little less happy, probably with the 40% isn't ever going to be on the far other side of the curve. But where they are still can be a great deal under their control. And another part of the good news here, in my opinion, is remember we talked about flourishing, how relatively few people are actually flourishing. There's a lot of room for most of us to move within wherever that genetic range is. Let's talk about health for 10 minutes and then we'll move on. So I'll have to fly through this. Nuns are great to study in terms of health. Why is that?
They have a pretty set type of lifestyle. They have support with their group and their communities. They tend to invest into each other's welfare as a group.
Yeah, so it's a community. But in some respects, their lives and their life course and their life work within a given order are relatively similar. Okay. So one of the things that was looked at, this was a retrospective study, but they found autobiographies that have been written by 180 Catholic nuns when they took their vows. And then they scored them for emotional content. How much positive emotion was expressed in these autobiographies. How optimistic did that nun seem, and so forth. And then they controlled for age and how much education they had. What they found was that the emotional content in their autobiographies was related to how long they lived. They lived a long time. So living to be 86 is a long time. But those in the lowest quartile of emotional content live about 7 years less than those with the highest positive emotional content. 7 years is a long time. When we talk about in healthcare, some health behaviors like smoking, often we don't see 7 years associated with whether or not you smoke. I mean, that's a big number. Now, this is one study. This is a shorter period of time. Almost 10,000 adults, they measured how happy they were and how satisfied they were. They found that even in a shorter period of time as 3 years, there were health differences among those who were happier and those who weren't. The upshot of all this is positive emotion seems to be a huge asset for our health. Our physical health. An analysis of 83 studies of optimism. Optimism has been looked at a couple of different ways here, and they included both ways of looking at optimism in this analysis. Optimism was a significant predictor of physical health, more so for subjective health than objective health. In other words, how well people felt was more related to optimism than was how well they were based on objective measures. But before you discount that, how well we feel is itself a pretty good predictor of how long we'll live. People who feel better. Now some of that is, however, in these studies, typically we control for how much illness might actually be present. And this relationship holds even when you take out negative emotion. Just another, there's more research with this. A study that was done based at Miami University in 1975, they enrolled about 1,100 people, and they were looking at their attitudes toward aging. And you can see some of the examples here. Things keep getting worse as I get older, how much they agreed with that statement. I have as much pep as I did last year. I'm as happy now as when I was younger, and so forth. So measuring how optimistic or positive they were about getting older. And they were able to follow about half of these folks, and they found 20 years later, those who had more positive attitudes toward aging, let's see, I think they had data on 660 of people who had actually died, if I remember correctly. And what they found was those who had more positive attitudes toward aging lived again about 7 years longer than those who had more negative views of aging. And then if you looked at which variables had an impact on survival, age was first, how old they were, but then the next one was self-perceptions of aging. That had a bigger predictive value than whether or not they were male or female, how lonely they were, what their functional health was, in other words, what they were able to do with activities of daily living and so forth, socioeconomic status. So in other words, my point is positive emotion itself turning out to be a fairly good predictor of health and longevity. We talked about this earlier. Older adults tend to be happier than young adults. Most older adults are not lonely. Some are. Most aren't. Most adapt rather successfully to physical difficulties that can and often occur as we get older. And the use it or lose it holds. And that's true for our brains as well as for our bodies.
Don't you think this has changed, though, in the last, like, 30 to 40 years? I mean, we have senior citizen centers. We have, you know, like, on the main, they have rec center where they have all types of activities for older people, you know. Water aerobics, you know, or not?
Well, that's you can argue that that's a positive change. I think one negative change is that families, extended families, don't tend to live in the same communities like they used to. So you find more older adults who are living in communities where their children and their grandchildren don't necessarily live in the same community. And I think that certainly has changed here over the past few decades
as
well.
So that makes them happier.
Well, I don't think that makes them happier. But I'm saying that could be a detractor from happiness, but that's something that's changed arguably in a more negative direction. But I would agree in terms of we have
I mean, I'm just
a lot
wondering,
of activity.
Has that changed? I mean, is that a change from a generation or two ago?
I don't know. You could argue that generations past had more positive views of their older members of society than we do. You know, you can find cultures and communities where the oldest members of the communities are the most revered. Is that the case in our culture?
That's
anything. It's
China, right?
Certainly, some of the Eastern cultures.
Yes.
They tend to be unhappy too.
Yeah, they were lower on the happy. Well, that was the overall population. Right?
That's right.
Venezuela still got me. Still got to figure that out.
Okay.
negative emotions, we talked about this in an earlier session as well, are associated with poorer health on average. The term negative affectivity would be kind of a predominance of experiencing negative emotions, where positive affectivity would be a predominance of more positive emotions. It turns out it looks like, again, this isn't a teeter-totter, that a person can have positive emotions and negative emotions almost simultaneously. On Saturday, I was at a memorial service. There were lots of tears. It's also a lot of laughter. So arguably those of us that were there were grieving the loss of our friend, but we could at the same time still be experiencing positive emotions. So when you measure, have somebody complete this, the PANAS measure, the positive affectivity, negative affectivity scale, a person can score fairly high on both positive affectivity and negative affectivity. It's not a teeter-totter again. For our health, the more we can have more positive affectivity and minimize, it's not that we want to deny ourselves negative emotions, that's part of the human experience, but hopefully manage the negative emotions well and nurture positive emotions seems to have a lot of health benefits. I think that might look like. So how does happiness and optimism affect our health? Well, probably through a number of pathways. The immunologic pathway. Caregivers of Alzheimer's patients have poorer response to immunizations than do their non-caregiving counterparts. So in other words, somebody who's experiencing chronic stress, their immune systems don't respond as robustly because of the stress as would somebody who's under less stress. That's actually been found with medical students during exam periods versus not exam periods. Yeah. Wound healing, same thing. More stress, slower wound healing, both with chronic stress and acute stress. Even on our genes, I'm not a geneticist by any means, but telomeres are on our DNA. It's been shown that chronic stress tends to shorten telomeres, which are a predictor of longevity. So we know there's a lot happening biologically. Emotionally, for example, one of the things we know is that when we're in negative mood states, we tend to have more inflammation in our bodies. Inflammation is associated with a number of chronic illnesses. Cognitive pathway, certainly how we think affects how we feel. Also cognitively, the more broadly often we can think, the better problem solving we can engage in. So there seem to be some cognitive benefits here. Socially, more social integration is associated with better health, even though we're exposed to more pathogens. But on average, we're still better off being among lots of people. People who are optimistic have fewer negative life events. Notice how I said that. People who are optimistic have fewer negative life events. Why could that be?
They don't view it as negative.
But what that, in some cases, it's yeah. But this would be, you're looking at it objectively. That it's not just how they view the event.
Could also be how they react to the particular event.
Okay. Yeah. Some of it's resilience. How they, because sometimes a negative life event, if you're not very resilient with it, is going to make you more vulnerable to another negative life event. Some of it's risk-taking. Somebody who's pessimistic, well, it doesn't matter, you got to die sometime, are more likely to put themselves in vulnerable positions, therefore more likely to have something negative happen to them. There's overlap in these as well. On average, optimistic people are more likely to have more social affiliation. Most people, if there's a choice between affiliating with somebody who's happier or somebody who's, what, Debbie Downer, it's going to gravitate toward the happier person. The behavioral pathway, optimism is associated with more positive health behaviors. People tend to take care of themselves with optimism. And then, as I said, these all overlap as well. So there, it's not just, my point is, it's not just that, you know, positive emotions, happiness, are associated with better health for no apparent reason. There are a number of reasons that have been studied scientifically, and we have evidence to support the mechanisms of action. Yes?
I just wanted to point out, I teach high school psychology. Okay. So, and my mom came in, her husband came in and spoke for years, and she's in her 80s now, and he's got dementia, so they don't come in anymore, but the students, every year they would ask her, what was your happiest time of your life? And she always, her answer was, is when had two brothers, is when the boys were in high school playing sports. So, I mean, I was just thinking about your, you know, so, how you were saying.
So she was probably, she probably has a lot of good memories associated with that.
But I don't know if it was, but I mean, that's how, that's what she recalls. Mm-hmm. So I don't.
I used to, my mother, who's now deceased, I remember when people would ask her, what was your favorite time with your children? And it kind of annoyed me, but she would say, all the times with my kids. Sort of like, isn't that a cop-out? But in retrospect now, I think, what a great way to look at it.
Yeah.
That she was able somehow to, you know, find joy even in tougher times and so forth. Well, it's 8:30, so I'm going to stop. Thank you for your attention. I apologize that I kind of rushed here toward the end, but hopefully there is something that you can take away. And I'll stick around, by the way, too.
Do you think it's possible to decide to be happy?
Absolutely. I would argue happiness occurs between our ears.